a todas, a todos, la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos les da la más cordial bienvenida a la presente audiencia sobre denuncias sobre discriminación y violencia basadas en orientación sexual e identidad de género contra niños y niñas en Guyana. Me acompañan en la mesa la comisionada vicepresidenta Rosa María Ortiz y también relatora para niñas y niños y adolescentes por parte de la comisión, así como la comisionada expresidenta Dinah Shelton, quien es también relatora para el ilustre estado de Guyana. La presente audiencia fue solicitada por Red Red, Artists in Direct Support, Family Awareness Conscious Together, Society Against Social Orientation, Discrimination and a Child Advocate en Guyana. Le damos la bienvenida a la digna de representación de las organizaciones peticionarias, así como a la digna delegación del ilustre estado de Guyana. Solicitaría que al momento de hacer uso de la palabra, cada una de las representaciones se sirvan también presentar a quienes van a intervenir. Tiene el uso de la palabra los representantes de las organizaciones peticionarias por un espacio de 20 minutos.
Commissioners, representatives of the state of Guyana, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I am Zanita Nicholson, Guyana Country Coordinator with Caribbean Vulnerable Communities Coalition and Secretary on the Board of Trustees for Society Against Sexual Orientation Discrimination. As part of a civil society delegation from Guyana, we present a submission on violence, sexual and gender identity issues affecting Guyanese children. The three main substantive issues that we will focus on are corporal punishment, which will be presented by Ms. Karen D'Souza, National Coordinator, Red Thread, Guyana, and Child Advocate, Daria Nicholson. Discrimination and abuse based on sexual orientation and gender identity will be presented by Ms. Annette Jondu, Executive Director, Family Awareness, Consciousness Together, and Comprehensive Sexuality Education in Schools will be presented by Desiree Edgell, Executive Director of Artists in Direct Support. I now hand you over to my colleague, Karen.
Good morning. Good morning. In Guyana, violence of various kinds is almost endemic in the home, in the community, against women, and against the most vulnerable in the society, children. This submission highlights one aspect of the violence against children, that is corporal punishment in schools. The most recent, if not the only formal examination of this violence, is reported in the widest study, Voices of Children, Experiences with Violence, where children between the ages of 7 and 15 were asked questions about their experiences in school, among others. The study confirmed what was already common knowledge, that violence is so normalized in the lives of our children that the majority of children interviewed believe this to be not only acceptable, but a necessary expression of the teacher's authority. Not all children, of course, held this view, and in this presentation, we are asking Daria to give voice to the other side of the coin, which is what all the children feel. Daria.
I forgot my social studies book at home, and when it was social studies time at school, the teacher normally walks around and asks us for our homework, so the teacher told me to stand. I did not get to explain why I forgot my book, so I felt very angry about that. But after she gave me lashes, I felt very embarrassed because the children were laughing at me, and I felt very sad because the teacher hurt my feelings for lashing me in the palm.
Thank you, Daria. Community consultations by official bodies over a number of years have served to make public the position of many parents who hold the view that their children need to be beaten, and teachers have expressed the fear that chaos will reign in the schools if they are not allowed to use the whip. The 2007 Draft Education Act, which was consulted on nationally, embeds the right of the schools to administer corporal punishment, and this is the first time that this actually appears in the education law. And the law includes all the provisions of the Ministry of Education guidelines on administering corporal punishment. So the law says, as the guidelines say, that corporal punishment may be administered to a student if no other punishment is considered suitable or effective in the particular case, that it may be administered by the principal, deputy principal, or a teacher specifically designated by the principal for the purpose, and it must be done in the principal's office or another private room in the school in the presence of another teacher, using an instrument prescribed by the regulations and in conformity with written guidelines. So an entry must be made in the punishment book. So this very clinical expression of how children should be beaten in the schools. In other areas of child care, the state recognizes the need to end the physical punishment of children. So, for example, in the Child Care and Development Services Act 2011, Part 3, Section 15, specifically forbids caregivers from subjecting children in their care to any form of corporal punishment or any abuse of any nature whatsoever. Needless to say, in both education system and in the Child Care Act, this is more observed in the breach, and it's constantly violated. But the state maintains the fiction that children are not being beaten in schools. So the beating is very casual, as Daria has relayed. Most recently, in 2012, a special select committee of the National Parliament invited written and oral submissions on the issue of corporal punishment. In our view, expending more resources on rehashing views already expressed, rather than allocating the necessary resources to public education on the issue for the prevention of violence and providing the additional support necessary in the schools. And this is notwithstanding the fact that most commissioners we understand in this select committee are in fact opposed to corporal punishment. So our view is that the state continues to pander to the misguided view that discipline equals control and punishment. With your permission, I'd like to raise an immediate matter that came up after the submission was made, which is not related to corporal punishment. And the issue is to put on the table the current situation of a pregnant 15-year-old who's been given permission by the High Court to marry the 38-year-old father of her child. In obedience to the Sexual Offences Act, the man has separately been charged with rape, but moves are afoot to dismiss these charges because of the marriage. This situation highlights the lack of consistency and coordination in application of the laws regarding children. Notwithstanding the enactment of a series of child-related protective legislation and also the need for some clear expression of what constitutes the best interests of the child. So this is now in contravention of the Education Act, which specifies education to 16, the Child Care and Protection Act, the Sexual Offences Act, and I believe several others. I'll now pass on to Annette.
Because of their real or perceived sexual orientation and gender identity, they face discrimination and abuse in the home, school environment, and community. In school, there is little or no support for children who fall into this group. Students face discrimination and are target not only by their peers, but sometimes by their teachers, whose personal views may be homophobic. Some LGBT students reported being harassed by their peers, and when they approached their teachers for support, they were punished because of their assumed actual sexual orientation or gender identity, instead of the offender. Further, there have been reported cases where if a child is identified as gay, whether real or perceived, that child is neglected or sometimes verbally abused by the teacher in the presence of the other students with insulting remarks. Most instances of abuse perpetrated against children because of their assumed sexual orientation and gender identity are unreported and undocumented, both because there are no actual or known system in place to treat these issues and because of the associated discrimination. SASOD, an NGO, was contacted when a 13-year-old boy was thrown out of his home and threatened with a cutlass by his father that he would be killed because he appeared to be gay. Afraid and alone, helpless, he sought refuge with all the peers who introduced him to the sex trade so that he could earn money to provide for his basic needs, food, clothing, shelter. The matter was reported to the Child Care and Protection Agency, which falls under the Ministry of Labor, Human Services, and Social Security. Child Care and Protection Agency intervened and placed the child with his grandmother, where the father had continued access and was able to continue the abuse and harassment. There was no legal intervention with the boy's father, who threatened him with deadly violence. The state has no effective system in place to deal with these kinds of issues where children are violently abused because of their sexual orientation and gender identity, whether real or perceived, by family, teachers, caregivers, or persons who are responsible for their well-being and safety. One lesbian, gay, and bisexual and transgender youth shared that he dropped out of school because of fear of being continually harassed and discriminated against in school for being perceived as gay, whilst others have indicated a decreased interest in school attendance and abstinence due to struggles with harassment and discrimination. This contradicts the efforts of the Ministry of Education, which is working on reducing the rate of school dropout, especially among boys. I'll now hand you over to my colleague, Desiree.
Thank you, Annette. I'm Desiree Edgell, and I'm the Executive Director of Artists in Direct Support. Guyana subscribed to the Caribbean community, that is CARICOM, Health and Family Life Education, HFLE program in 2003. However, for years, little progress had been made in its implementation through the school system. It wasn't until 2010 that the Ministry of Education, having recognized an increase in violence in some secondary schools and other problems such as teenage pregnancy and drug abuse, started implementing the HFLE program as a timetabled subject in schools. On a check with the Cyril Potter College, that is the National Teachers Training College, it was revealed that the HFLE program is still being taught, but mainly to social studies teachers. Teachers have also indicated that they are finding it difficult to do the extra work. The head of the Cyril Potter also indicated that the Ministry of Education was recently doing checks in some schools to see if the HFLE program was being done, but did not share their findings with the college. Further, NGOs who worked along with teachers to implement the HFLE program in schools found that the teachers were not only behind in the rollout of the HFLE manual, but they were also selecting certain exercises to conduct rather than following the format of the manual and how they were trained to execute them. During interviews with four schools about the HFLE program, the responses were as follows. One, the HFLE program was not being executed because of time constraints on the children's schedule. Two, the teacher who conducted the program had migrated and they had no other trained teacher. Three, the program is being carried out during the guidance period, but not consistently. And four, the program is being carried out, but the children are not attentive. They display no interest. The current strategy of the Guyana's Ministry of Education facilitates teachers addressing the thematic area of the HFLE program from a very heterosexist perspective. There are no systems in place for teachers to explore the internal conflicts between their personal and professional values in order to effectively deliver the curriculum and address the needs of all their students, including those who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender, or still discovering their sexual orientation and/or gender identity. A local education official reiterated a widely held view that because of social and cultural taboos, many teachers are not comfortable discussing sex and sexuality issues. Information about health and sexuality is one of the only critical tools that young people have to protect themselves from diseases and to make informed decisions about their well-being and sexuality. Information also creates cultural change and has helped to prevent violence and discrimination. The ideology behind the Education Ministry's abstinence-only policy seems to suggest a concern that an abstinence-plus approach to sexuality education in Guyana would encourage children to engage in sexual activity. But according to the Guyana Biological Behavioral Surveillance Survey, BBSS 2008-2009 report, 27% of in-school youth are sexually active, and the average age of sexual debut is 14 years old. 24% reported that they have been forced to have sex, while 25% of the males admitted that they had forced someone to have sex. To date, no formal analysis of the HFLE program has been conducted to evaluate its impact and its effectiveness. I now hand you back to our moderator, Ms. Zanita Nicholson.
Thank you, Desiree. The proposed recommendations to the government of Guyana under the issue of corporal punishment are as follows. One, provide trained resources in schools to ensure that children with emotional and behavioral issues are given the help that they need. Two, intensify teacher training in the classroom management. And three, immediately abolish the use of violence in schools. Under the issue of discrimination and abuse based on sexual orientation and gender identity, we recommend that, one, educate the Guyana Police Force on enforcing the Protection of Children Act 2009 and other legislation which protects children's rights. Two, educate the probation officers to deal effectively with cases of abuse and review and strengthen the Child Protection Act and national child care and protection policies to address homophobic and transphobic violence and child abuse. Three, create and sustain safe spaces for children who have been turned out from their homes and or are victims of all forms of abuse. In this facility, children should have at least access to food, clothing, schooling, and counseling. Four, implement a mechanism for reporting and redress where teachers who abuse children, including because of their real or perceived sexual orientation and gender identity, are held accountable for their behavior. Under the issue of comprehensive sexuality education in schools, we recommend that to review the sex and sexuality theme in the health and family life education curriculum to incorporate objective information on sexual orientation and gender identity aimed at preventing violence, abuse, and discrimination in schools. Two, include training in the teachers' training college curriculum on managing conflicting values in the classroom and on understanding of SOGI issues. Three, undertake and publish an independent evaluation of the current health and family life education curriculum and implement recommendations to provide comprehensive sexuality education in schools. Four, comply with the Educating to Prevent Ministerial Declaration signed in 2008 and provide comprehensive sexuality education in schools. Six, collaborate with NGOs to roll out the health and family life program in schools. And if you may permit me, I have three proposed recommendations to the committee. They are, one, follow up with the government of Guyana on what has been reported. We recommend in particular the Rapporteur on the Rights of the Child. Two, that the state of Guyana and the Commission work very closely together to address these issues. And lastly, we urge that the Commission consider that sexual orientation and gender identity are a vital part of a child's development, and any impediment to the process should be viewed as a violation of the right of the child. Thank you.
Muchas gracias a la digna representación de las organizaciones peticionarias por su presentación. Perdón. Le daría el uso de la palabra ahora, disculpen ustedes, le daría el uso de la palabra a la digna delegación del ilustre estado de Guyana, quien está conformada por la honorable Jennifer Wester, ministra de Servicios Humanos y Seguridad Social, así como por el embajador Benny Carr, representante permanente de Guyana ante la Organización de Estados Americanos. Gracias por estar con nosotros. Tienen uso la palabra.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, other distinguished members of the Commission, our petitioners. Good morning, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I am Jennifer Webster, Minister of Human Services of the Government of Guyana, and to my left is the Honorable Ambassador, Mr. Benny Karan, our Ambassador to the United States of America. Mr. Chairman, first of all, permit me to just to make a few points on behalf of the Government of Guyana about some concerns that we have with respect to procedural issues before I begin my presentation formally. The government has taken note of Section 4, Article 48, which states that when the Commission receives a petition or communication alleging violation of any of the rights protected by this convention, it shall proceed as follows. A, if it considers the petition or communication inadmissible, it shall request information from the government of the state indicated as being responsible for the alleged violations, and shall furnish that government a transcript of the pertinent portions of the petition or communication. The information shall be submitted within a reasonable period to be determined by the Commission in accordance with the circumstances of each case. The Commission may request the states concerned to furnish any pertinent information, and if so requested, shall hear oral statements or receive written statements from the parties concerned. The government notes that the IACHR has done so in accordance with the above-mentioned procedures, but that it has only given the country 20 days. Furthermore, the government, in light of the petitioner's statement that the government has failed to protect children, finds Article 20 of greater interest. In relation to those member states of the organization that are not parties to the American Convention on Human Rights, the Commission shall have the following powers, in addition to those designated in Article 18. To examine communications submitted to it and any other available information to address the government of any member state not a party to the convention for information deemed pertinent by this commission, and to make recommendations to it when it finds this appropriate in order to bring about more effective observance of fundamental human rights, and to verify as a prior condition to the exercise of the powers granted under subparagraph B whether the domestic legal procedures and remedies of each member state not a party to the convention have been duly applied and exhausted. The government, on examining the rules of procedure of the IACHR, notes that it provides for non-governmental entities to submit petitions concerning alleged violations of a human right as follows. Article 23. Presentation of petitions. Any person or group of persons or non-governmental entities legally recognized in one or more of the member states of the OAS may submit petitions to the Commission on their behalf or on behalf of third persons concerning alleged violations of a human right, recognized in accordance with their respective provisions, the statute of the Commission, and these rules of procedure. The government notes that Chapter 2, petitions referring to the American Convention on Human Rights and other applicable instruments, provides under the guidelines, Article 28, requirements for the considerations of petitions. Petitions addressed to the Commission shall contain the following. Paragraph 8 says, any steps taken to exhaust domestic remedies or the impossibility of doing so as provided in Article 31 of these rules of procedure. And as Guyana has only received pertinent sections of the request from a hearing, it cannot ascertain if the petitioners have provided the information required in Article 28H. Article 30, admissibility procedures. The Commission, through its Executive Secretariat, shall process the petitions that meet the requirements set forth in Article 28 of these rules of procedure. The state shall submit its response within 2 months from the date the request is transmitted. The Executive Secretariat shall evaluate requests for extensions of this period that are duly founded. However, it shall not grant extensions that exceed 3 months from the date of the first request for information sent to the state. Prior to deciding upon the admissibility of the petition, the Commission may invite the parties to submit additional observations, either in writing or in a hearing, as provided for in Chapter 6 of these rules of procedure. Any considerations or on challenges to the admissibility of the petition shall be submitted from the time that the relevant parts of the petition are forwarded to the state and prior to the Commission's decision on admissibility. In compliance with Article 30, Section 6, Guyana's concerns are contained in this presentation to the IACHR. Mr. Chairman, I will now make a formal response on behalf of the government of Guyana. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, first of all, let me begin by referring to the communication which was sent to the government of Guyana dated September 27, 2013, and which was received on September 30, 2013, giving us 20 days in which to submit to the Commission a summary of the main points of this presentation. I wish to place on record that the government finds the time given to submit an initial response and to prepare for a full presentation to this session as extraordinarily short. Needless to say, the government of Guyana does not intend to shirk from its responsibility to defend the policies which it has adopted and to address the specific question which is the subject of this hearing today. Guyana, as you may be aware, has ratified the following international human rights treaties: the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the International Covenant on Social, Economic, and Cultural Rights, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, the Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the Optional Protocol on Children in Armed Conflict, and the Optional Protocol on the Sale of Children, Child Prostitution, and Child Pornography, and 6, the Convention Against Torture. The Convention for the Rights of Migrant Workers and Their Families. Guyana was reviewed by the UNHRC UPR process in May and September 2010, at which a number of recommendations were made and those to which the government made commitments. Included in these were the 3 most controversial for the country and its citizens: the abolition of corporal punishment, the abolition of the death penalty, and the decriminalization of adult same-sex relations and discrimination against lesbians, gays, bisexuals, and transgenders, to which the government committed to hold national consultations to reflect the democratic will of the people. The Ministry of Education in 2011 and in 2012 held community meetings across the country, which included meetings with parent teachers associations and the Guyana Teachers Union on the issue of the abolition of corporal punishment in the schools. The public views were divided almost evenly for and against. As a result, the government brought a motion in the National Assembly on August 9, 2012, to establish a parliamentary special select committee to examine and make recommendations on the same 3 recommendations of the UNHRC to the National Assembly. This resolution was adopted Vice Resolution 23 of 2012. The Special Select Committee was appointed on October 18, 2012, and began meeting on November 28, 2012, and has continued to function. It has invited submissions from the public with regard to the abolition of corporal punishment in schools. 2 of the bodies here, the Red Thread and the SASAD, have made submissions to this committee in May 2013. The committee has not concluded its work and will be holding hearings based on the written submissions it received. With regard to the annex with the pertinent sections provided to the government by the IACHR from the NGOs concerning discrimination against children based on gender identity, we have noted that one of those refers to an allegation of discrimination against children based on gender identity. The government wishes to state it is not aware of any reports being made on such a case and would like to be provided with this information. However, the government reiterates that there are adequate complaint mechanisms in place with the Ministry of Education, the Child Care and Protection Agency, and the Constitutional Rights of the Child Commission. The government would also like the Commission to note Guyana's 7 to 8 state party periodic reports were reviewed before the CEDAW at its 52nd session in July 2012. 2 international non-governmental organizations, the Global Initiative to End Corporal Punishment and the International Disability Alliance, made written submissions to the CEDAW to which the government responded. Guyana's second to fourth state party periodic report on the Convention on the Rights of the Child was reviewed as recently as January 2013 at the 62nd session of the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child. In paragraph 20 of the state party response, we reported that the government had taken the UPR recommendations to the National Assembly and had appointed a parliamentary special select committee. For Guyana's review before the Committee on the Rights of the Child, two papers were submitted by non-governmental organizations. These were the International Disability Alliance and the combined submission of the Society Against Sexual Orientation Discrimination, Artists in Direct Support, the Family Awareness Consciousness Together, FACT, and Red Thread, entitled Sexuality and Gender Issues Affecting Children in Guyana, a joint submission under the Convention on the Rights of the Child. This submission focused on three main issues: the comprehensive sex and sexuality education in schools, access to sexual health information, and discrimination and abuse based on sexual orientation and gender identity. The government has taken note that these three main issues have been reiterated in the pertinent sections of the request for a hearing that was enclosed in the annex sent to the government by the IACHR. Guyana has also ratified the Charter of the Organization of the American States and remains committed to upholding its articles and objectives. Guyana remains particularly committed to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child and supports Article 19, Rights of the Child, of the American Declaration of the Rights and Duties of Man, albeit not being a signatory to it. Every minor has the right to the measures of protection required by his condition as a minor on the part of his family, society, and the state. The government recognizes and is committed to adopting measures with a view to achieving progressively by legislation or other appropriate means the full realization of the rights implicit in the economic, social, educational, scientific, and cultural standards set forth in the Charter of the Organization of American States as amended by the Protocol of Buenos Aires, as set out in Chapter 3, Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, Article 26, Progressive Development. The government has made major progress with the regard to the realization of the rights of children in Guyana, as documented in its state party periodic reports before the UNCRC and the UNHRC. With regard to the attainment of the Millennium Development Goals, these good faith efforts to uphold these human rights have led to the achievement of universal primary enrollment in primary school, as well as gender parity in enrollment of girls in the primary and secondary school system. Guyana is working towards universal secondary education within the next 3 years. It has achieved the target set for poverty reduction and has reduced infant and child mortality. The government asked the Commission to note that it has submitted information on children in response to requests, September 22, 2011, response to the IACHR, request on the situation of children and adolescents in care and protection institutions in the Americas, the OAS request for information on criminal justice in the Americas on March 2, 2011, May 25, 2011, correspondence in response to Mr. Paulo Sergio Pinheiro, Commissioner and Rapporteur on the Rights of Children, with regard to corporal punishment and the human rights of children and adolescents. The government wishes to draw the attention of the IACHR to Chapter 7 of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, Section 3, Competence, Article 44. Any person or group of persons or any non-governmental entity legally recognized in one or more member states of the organization may lodge petitions with the commission containing denunciations or complaints of violation of this convention by a state party. The government wishes to state that not all the four NGOs that have requested a hearing are legally recognized. The Red Thread and the FACT have been registered under the Friendly Societies Act of Guyana, Chapter 3604, in 2008 and 2009, respectively. However, neither organization has complied with the submission of audited reports, which is a compliance. The ARTIS in direct support and the SASAD are not duly registered. The government has noted Article 45.2, which states communications presented by virtue of this article may be admitted and examined only if they are presented by a state party that has made a declaration recognizing the aforementioned competence of the commission. The commission shall not admit any communication against a state party that has not made such a declaration. Guyana has not made such a declaration. The government has noted Article 46, which states admission by the commission of a petition or communication lodged in accordance with Articles 44 or 45 shall be subject to the following requirements. Guyana is of the view that the existence of the Parliamentary Special Select Committee, wherein two of the four NGOs making the joint submission to the IACHR have made a submission on the abolition of corporal punishment. This illustrates that firstly, there is an ongoing process to address the issues raised.
Me parece podría tener dos minutos para... Two minutes, please, to conclude.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to address the issue of domestic remedies. Guyana cannot ascertain if the petitioners have so indicated to the IACHR in keeping with Article 31.3, and therefore the government can only state what is available ongoing on domestic remedies. The government is of the opinion that the joint submission to the UN Committee in January 2013, in which Guyana was thoroughly and exhaustively questioned on these and other issues during the review process, constitutes a duplication of the subject matter before the IACHR. In conclusion, the government is therefore of the view that the request for a hearing of a general nature in accordance with Chapter 6, Article 62, 64, and 66, appears not to be in accordance with the rules of the procedure of the IACHR. And Chapter 11, petitions referring to the American Declaration of the Rights and Duties of Man, Articles 28, 30, 31, and 33. Domestic remedies are in existence and are in operation, to which the NGOs making the submission for a hearing have been responsive. The domestic remedies may take time, but there has been no hindrance or impediment for any citizen or non-governmental organization to have their views heard. The joint submission of the four NGOs appear to be similar in substance to the one presented to the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child, and therefore appears to be duplication. Guyana is not opposed to presenting its record of efforts to address the situation of children in Guyana and has no difficulties doing so at any international, regional, national, or community forum, as it continues to make efforts to comply with its treaty obligations before the UNHRC and the UN Rights of the Child Convention. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gracias. La honorable ministra de Ilustre Estado de Guyana por su presentación en relación con la con los aspectos procedimentales que se permitió manifestar, quisiera precisar de que varias de las disposiciones del reglamento de la Comisión Interamericana a los que hizo referencia efectivamente se refieren al capítulo segundo del reglamento, que son artículos 26 y siguientes, relacionados con las peticiones individuales relacionadas con presuntas violaciones a los derechos humanos. Sin embargo, el presente procedimiento, que está relacionado con las audiencias públicas que se llevan en la Comisión Interamericana, está regulado en el capítulo sexto, que son los artículos, entre otros, 61, 62 y 66, en el cual se confiere atribuciones a la Comisión relacionadas con recibir información de carácter general o particular relacionada con los derechos humanos en uno o más estados miembros de la Organización de Estados Americanos. Este aspecto también proviene del artículo 106 de la Carta de la Organización de Estados Americanos, que le confiere a la Comisión el mandato de promover y defender los derechos humanos en todos y cada uno de los países de la miembros de la Organización de Estados Americanos. Es con base en ese mandato general previsto en el artículo 106 de la Carta de la OEA, así como en lo correspondiente al Estatuto de la Comisión Interamericana, que se regula en el capítulo sexto de la Comisión, reitero, artículos 62 y 66 principalmente del reglamento de la Comisión Interamericana, el procedimiento que debe seguirse para las audiencias públicas. La anticipación con la que se debe hacer, notificar al Estado para participar en una audiencia pública está precisamente previsto en el párrafo quinto del artículo 66, que se refiere a las audiencias de carácter general y que debe ser con 30 días de anticipación. Apreciamos mucho la participación de ilustre Estado de Guyana en esta audiencia. Ciertamente es la primera vez que los hace y que nos da mucho gusto que participe en alguno de los mecanismos más importantes que tiene la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos para monitorear la situación de los derechos humanos en los países de la región y recibir información precisamente de carácter general, en este caso más particular, respecto de un tema importante para los derechos humanos. Yo le cedería el uso de la palabra a la comisionada expresidenta Dinah Shelton y relatora para Guyana.
Thank you very much, President. Thank you both to the petitioners and to the state for your participation in the hearing and the information that you've given. I would like to ask some questions first of those who have come to present this matter to us today. One is whether there are limits on the types of corporal punishment that are imposed, the ages at which it may be imposed, procedural safeguards or abilities to complain after it has happened, just to get more information about the actual situation. For our young participant, I'd like to know how old you are and whether your teacher was a man or a woman. In reference to the age of consent for sexual activity, is there a legal age below which it is presumed consent cannot be given? And similarly, with respect to marriage. Mm. And then finally, are there any laws, policies, or measures to combat bullying and private violence? That is when it's not the agents of the state themselves. So those are my questions for the petitioner. For the government, I'd like to First, reiterate some of what the president said. This is a great teaching moment to reaffirm the powers in the statute, the functions that have been given to the commission, and the authority by which a hearing has been held. This could not be classified as a petition under the jurisprudence of the commission. It cannot be, because we have no named victims. There is no specific allegation of a specific person or persons whose rights have been violated. So we could not even begin to process this, nor would it happen without information about exhaustion of local remedies. The basis on which the commission holds these hearings lies in Articles 18, 19, and 20 of the statute. Article 20 tells the commission to pay particular attention to certain rights. Among them is the right to personal security and the right to equality, both of which are raised in this particular issue. And this is absolutely the most common type of hearing, where we are requested to take information about assertions of a general situation within one or more countries. Insofar as the materials presented to the United Nations, we're of course not subordinate to the United Nations. We have our own laws, our own procedures, but we do pay attention, and we are aware of the reports that have gone to the UN treaty bodies and the UPR, and the recommendations that have been made, which I think we would probably support. And also congratulate the government for its ratification record and for being willing to submit itself to the type of scrutiny that it has and to take seriously the recommendations that have been made. I think this is all very positive, and it is positive that you've taken these recommendations back to the national level and started a process there. I made an on-site visit to Jamaica just a couple of weeks ago, where we presented our country study based on an on-site visit. And similar types of issues arose there, and the issue of public opinion. And I will say, with all due respect to the government, what I said in Jamaica, that one cannot put human rights to a vote. It would not be acceptable in the southern parts of the United States to put segregation or slavery to a vote as to whether people want to have it or not. And I think the issue has to be one of government leadership, even sometimes in advance of public opinion. And that includes, and this is actually a question I have, positive measures to prevent violence, whatever the motivation for the violence. So my question is whether there are measures in place, this is similar to the question I asked the petitioners, to combat violence and bullying in schools or out of schools. You're of course free to comment on any of the questions I ask the petitioners. and just cite that, as I said, in going to Jamaica, I was struck in listening to your presentation how similar some of the issues are in other countries in the Caribbean. Over the past 3 years since the commission issued its report on Jamaica, the commissioner of police, together with civil society organizations, started a diversity policy. And there has been an enormous change in the response to issues of mob violence or attacks on persons who are perceived as being either gay or lesbian, that both civil society and the government reported has decreased the levels of violence generally in society. So there's a lot that you are doing, a lot that can be done, and I thank you for coming and participating today.
Gracias, comisionada. Tiene la palabra la comisionada vicepresidenta Rosa María Ortiz.
Muchas gracias, señor presidente. Muchas gracias, señora ministra de Servicios Sociales y Seguridad Social, y el señor embajador representante permanente ante la OEA del ilustre estado de Guyana. Muchas gracias también a los peticionarios, especialmente a la pequeña peticionaria con nosotros por participar de este diálogo en esta audiencia que nos permite conocer de qué manera Guyana está trabajando para asegurar todos los derechos humanos de las personas que integran su población. Estamos muy agradecidos por la valiente presencia aquí de la niña que nos acompaña. Muchas gracias por venir hasta aquí y contarnos de qué manera vive en la escuela una niña que ha sufrido el castigo corporal. Y sobre todo me impresiona que no es solamente que nos ha hecho llegar lo que sintió al ser castigada corporalmente, sino la vergüenza que le dio que se lo haya hecho en frente de los compañeritos. Entonces, todo eso nos ayuda a ver a los niños y niñas como sujetos de derechos y como sujetos de derechos que tienen voz y que pueden también participar en la búsqueda de las soluciones de los problemas que se plantean. Por eso, otra vez, muchas gracias por su participación. Y decía también gracias a las autoridades porque vemos que Guyana es un país que está tomando en serio su responsabilidad en el cumplimiento de los derechos ante los distintos organismos. Veo que en el Comité de Derechos del Niño también presentaron y el comité les felicitó por los avances en cuanto a la prohibición de castigo corporal en las instituciones de cuidado de niños. Y eso está en el Child Care and Development Services Act de 2011. La pregunta sería si así como tomaron la decisión de prohibir el castigo corporal en instituciones, si piensan y si el debate está hecho en la sociedad de Guyana como para avanzar, porque si es malo el castigo corporal y es degradante para los niños que viven en instituciones, también lo es dentro de la familia y también lo es dentro de la escuela. Entonces, la pregunta sería si está avanzando el debate como para que estas situaciones que aquí se plantean de castigo corporal, pero también de discriminación, que es un tipo de violencia muy importante, como la discriminación en cuanto a la orientación sexual en las escuelas, si existen los espacios de discusión con los propios niños y niñas y con las organizaciones de la sociedad civil como para ir avanzando en el tratamiento de estos derechos. También teniendo en cuenta las convenciones sobre discriminación recientemente adoptadas en la OEA. Eso sería, por razones de tiempo, las preguntas. Muchas gracias.
Sí, gracias, comisionada. Bien, yo también agradecería, ya sea en este momento, con posterioridad, cualquier información estadística o que se pudiera aportar sobre algunas las personas que fueran sujetas a procesos con base en las en los delitos que se relacionados con la orientación sexual o la identidad de género, que si hubiese información que se aporte sobre el particular y si no la relevancia de que se tuviera, pero sobre todo las medidas que se estuvieran tomando precisamente para erradicar del marco jurídico leyes que podrían de manera directa criminalizar el ejercicio libre de la orientación sexual o la identidad de género en general y sobre todo relacionado con niñas, niños, con el objeto de cumplir con las obligaciones internacionales. Yo no, evidentemente hay ya poco tiempo, ya rebasamos el tiempo fijado para esta audiencia. La información que estaríamos solicitando no es tanto que en este momento nos la proporcionen, sino con posterioridad, tanto las organizaciones peticionarias como ilustre Estado de Guyana. Les pediría su comprensión en que en este momento solo pudiéramos asignar 3 minutos a cada representación para algún comentario final que desearan formular. 3 minutos, por favor. Las peticiones.
Thank you. Responding to the questions directly, the nursery school kids are, in terms of education policy, are not supposed to be hit at all in the schools. Primary school starts at 5 years, 9 months, and we know that primary school kids are being hit in the schools. Procedures to make complaints are problematic because parents who may wish to complain are about teachers' violence are generally restrained by their kids because they're afraid of further victimization in the school. So in terms of real measures, I would say there are none. The law was changed a couple of years ago so that the age of consent for sexual activity is now 16. It was raised from 13. The age of marriage, I believe, is 18, but the law, the Marriage Act, permits a petitioner of 16 years of age to get permission from the High Court to be married with permission from the parents. In terms of policies around bullying and private violence and so forth, the guidelines recommend that males should be punished in their hands or on their buttocks, while females must be punished in their hands, that the head teacher should use either a cane or a strap no longer than 24 inches, that cases of corporal punishment must be carefully documented in the misdemeanors book. The reality, however, is that teachers have whips and various kinds of implements that are used on the kids in the classroom. So the regulations are not followed. Daria, you were going to answer about your teacher and...
I am 8 years old and my teacher is a female. You're welcome.
Gracias. No, ¿tendrían un minuto más? ¿Lo desean hacer uso de la palabra, por favor?
Just want to say that the minister is a little misinformed in terms of the legal status of the organizations. I can certainly say that Red Thread is not required under the Act to submit audited statements. We do have to submit financial reports, which we have done. We have not received any communication from the relevant agency. SASSED is registered by trust deed, which was done in 2006. And has been provided and can provide the relevant information.
That's me. We were registered in 2000 under the Companies Act, refunded by PEPFAR, and it's a requirement that the organization be registered in order to access funding from the U.S. So we are a funded legal entity.
Gracias nuevamente a las representantes y al representante de la de las organizaciones peticionarias por su participación. Tiene el uso de la palabra la delegación del Estado de Gobierno.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The government of Guyana wishes to take note of the response by the petitioner and to indicate that we will certainly commit ourselves to providing a formal response to the Commission. I would also like to perhaps briefly address the issues, the three main issues. In my capacity as chairperson of the Special Select Committee of the Parliament, we have been mandated to address these three main issues. And the committee is working, and we hope to conclude our deliberation shortly. The committee has been given the mandate by the legislative, and I've noted the concerns of the commission. What I would like to say is that the government of Guyana will do whatever it takes to ensure that we work together with all NGOs, especially as it relates to our children, to end violence in our schools. And with respect to the issue of what we intend to do, I wish to state that at the level of the Ministry of Education, there are mechanisms in place for complaints to be made. And I have noted that the petitioner has made reference to some specific cases for which we would like to have them duly investigated with a view to providing a formal response to the specific cases. At the level of the Parliament, we are going to have consultations with our children on the issue of the abolition of corporal punishment, because we feel that their views are the most important views to what should happen. And we would be doing that very shortly, and we hope to have a wide cross-section of children in the Guyanese society participate and to hear their views and to act on their recommendations. I thank you.
Gracias, honorable ministra. Reiteramos nuestro reconocimiento tanto a la digna representación de las organizaciones peticionarias como a la digna delegación del ilustre Estado de Guyana por su participación. La Comisión Interamericana seguirá abierta a recibir información complementaria porque continuará monitoreando la situación de la discriminación y violencia basadas en la orientación sexual e identidad de género contra niñas y niños en Guyana. Muchas gracias. Reanudamos en 3 minutos para la siguiente audiencia.